My name is Lisa Kriederman. I'm an incident meteorologist as well as a forecaster for the National Weather Service. I have been with NOAA for almost 19 years, and I have worked in about four forecast offices. I started in the Tucson Weather Forecast Office down in Arizona, and then I hopped a boat and went out to Honolulu, Hawaii, to the forecast office out there. And then I headed north to the cold, to the Anchorage, Alaska office. And now I'm currently here at the Boulder office, and I've been here for about 12 years. I got my start being an incident meteorologist just because of my love of being outdoors, being in the elements. I love camping. What an incident meteorologist is a specially trained meteorologist who goes out to incidences, which most likely we do like 95% about just wildfires across the country. We can also do other incidences like earthquake recovery. We can do hurricane recovery. We've also done large public gatherings where they need on-site meteorological support. So we're trained to do all that. But most of our work is at wildfires. So we are specially trained in mountain meteorology, as well as how fires behave due to different vegetation. We also get special training for more micrometeorology, just to know how weather can go through different mountains and topography and how that affects a wildfire. So my start as an incident meteorologist, I really got started in the program because of the amount of wildfires that there were in Arizona when I was working there in the Tucson office, as well as when I went to the Anchorage, Alaska office. There is a lot of wildfire up in Alaska. So I really got my start there, and I was trained up and became certified, and then came down here to the Front Range in Colorado, where we definitely have a lot of wildfire activity, and coming into the urban interface, that is also an issue. So we are a very great asset on any of these incidences, especially along the Front Range with so many people involved. As an incident meteorologist, we study the interactions of what we call the fire triangle. You need topography, fuels, and weather, and that's the fire behavior triangle. So between those three things, weather is the one thing that changes the most. And so wildfire incidences, they'll bring on a technical specialist, myself or any of the other 80 plus around the country. And we are brought on to the incident to, number one, provide for safety for those on the ground, most likely the wildland firefighters or anyone else who is helping. So we are there to help provide safety with a weather watch. We keep our eyes on the radar, on satellite, and as well as other weather observations, just to make sure that they are safe. We are also brought on for tactical reasons, so in order to contain or put out or kind of redirect certain fires, the incident management team will look at what weather is coming in, maybe in the next 24 hours, the next 3 days, 5 days, and we're there to help assist them and give them the forecast. We bring all of our own equipment with us, so we bring our laptop with us. We have communications if there is none up yet, so that we can have internet access. We also bring some other instruments. We also can deploy and put up these state weather stations on wildfires. They're called incident remote automated weather stations. So those we can deploy around a fire or whatever incident it is. And that way we can keep track of the weather that's coming in or that affects it. The most helpful reason that an incident meteorologist is on an incident is to be that on-site weather support who can really dial in to that small area. We are also trained to become accustomed to and really figure out a local area quickly, because there are only about 80 plus or minus of us across the country who are specially trained. Then at times, we can't just cover the wildfire incidences that are right in our forecast area. Sometimes we need to bring in other IMETs from other areas of the country. Sometimes we need to go to other areas of the country. So we are able to dispatch really anywhere in the United States they need us. And we try to get there very quickly, a lot of times before, within the 24 hours that we were called upon. A typical day for an IMET, we usually say we're the first to rise and last to go to bed, just because we need to prepare ourselves and look at what happened throughout the weather the previous day and what's expected to come the next day. So we get up very early to start looking over data. We coordinate with the local National Weather Service to make sure that we're on the same page. And then we usually have our morning crew briefing, where we brief the firefighters on the upcoming weather that's expected for that day. So they know what they're walking into during that day of work. So those morning crew briefings usually happen around 6 a.m., 6 or 7 a.m. Then we go right into looking at the forecast for the next day. We also give a lot of briefings to the incident management team. We also brief the community that we're in, because having a wildfire in your own space where you live is quite nerve-wracking. So we are there to provide information both on what the incident management team is doing, as well as what weather is coming up, and is that a good thing or a bad thing, and what the incident management team has scheduled to do. We'll go out into the field and take our own weather observations and talk to the firefighters out there, see what they're seeing. We'll also set up our instruments if we have them, the incident remote automated weather stations, the IRAWs. We will also come back in, and we may have some media that want to do interviews, especially if it's in the wildland urban interface. We'll also brief VIPs, maybe governors, people who just are really involved in it and want to know more information. We gather all of the weather observations that come in from the field. The firefighters usually are taking weather observations on the hour every hour. So we try to get those in, and that we can bring back in and try to formulate, an even clearer picture of what's going on in terms of the weather around a fire, and then incorporate that into the oncoming weather pattern that may be coming in. And then we just keep doing that. And if there's a night crew, we will brief them at night before they head out. And then we still look at some weather data, model data, and we collaborate with the weather service offices just to make sure we have a good picture before we go to bed. And that is usually very, very late, around 10 p.m. or so. So they're very long days, 16-hour days, but it is all worth it, because we are taking care of those people, putting their lives on the line. We're making sure that they are safe, and making sure we're bringing all of our expertise to help the incident management teams control and contain the wildfires. So the fire year, the summer of 2020, was quite a bad year for wildfires, and we also had to deal with the effects of COVID. So what we had to do was reach out to all the IMETs and figure out if they were able to go out, if they were able to be that on-site support, or some people chose to only do remote support. So depending on the incident and how severe it was, how many resources, how many people were on it, maybe the fire activity, there were some incidents that were supported remotely. I ended up going to two to be on-site. There was one here in Colorado and one in Utah. Then I also supported two incidences remotely, where I would be at my office and I had all my tools to be able to be dialed in and know all the weather information that was going on. And I just had to, you know, talk over the phone with the incident management team a lot more so that we definitely had that communication, because that's one of the most important parts of being an incident meteorologist, is being there and being able to answer questions at any time. Any plan that the incident management team has, if there was a weather component that may affect that, then they needed to know those answers right away. So we had to have very good coordination on the phone, as well as, you know, through email, sending documents. I would get sent weather observations. So the COVID aspect definitely changed the way that we provided our service, but we still provided that that life-saving safety weather watch that we would do, as well as providing the most detailed and specific forecasts that we could to the incident management team. So being an IMET is a very tough job, and it requires a lot of knowledge, a lot of dedication, a lot of just being able to zone in and provide that service. But it is definitely one of my favorite parts of my job. It is very rewarding, the camaraderie that you have with that incident management team, as well as the firefighters, is second to none. And then all of my IMETs that I work with as well, we're always talking to each other. We're supporting each other, checking in with each other if you're on an incident, and making sure everything is going okay. It's definitely one of the most fun parts of being a National Weather Service employee and forecaster.